everyone, and welcome back to my channel. Today I want to start a reading vlog that is very exciting to me because I am starting the first of the 5 series that I want to marathon read this year, and that is the Gilded Wolves Trilogy by Roshani Chokshi. So I'm very, very excited to get to these books. I have these like very fun editions. I also do like the original covers, but when I ordered them, this is what I got. So yeah, I do like these. Now, this is a series that has been compared to Six of Crows because we have kind of this found family group of characters who are kind of thieves, but they're also like puzzle solvers and like very intelligent and stuff like that. And this is set in the 1800s Paris. So definitely a lot of differences from the Six of Crows, but it's kind of like a, if you like this, you like that kind of deal. So I'm very intrigued to read this series. Now, I started this one on the train yesterday, but the way this works is that I always give you updates at the halfway point of each book and then when I've finished each book. So I'm not going to go into too much detail right now because I'm only a quarter of the way into this one. But from what I gathered, what's going on, we basically have this world with kind of like a secret society hidden thing that is based on the Tower of Babel, which obviously reminded me of Babel the book, and I had never heard people talk about that. So I was kind of confused, or like surprised rather, that this also deals with like the idea of the Tower of Babel and colonialism. So yeah, and now I want to read Babel to compare it to this. But basically, when the tower was destroyed, there were these fragments that were spread all over the world. I think it's 5 of these fragments. And where they landed, they give a kind of power, which is called forging, which is also a little bit confusing because I'm currently listening to the Farseer trilogy, and there is a technique of forging as well, but it's like very different from that. But basically, it is kind of a magic that has to do with creation. And so, yeah, certain things, objects can be forged to be kind of like magically enhanced and changed. So that's the basic setup, and we have these 4 houses that kind of belong to this like secret society kind of thing in Paris, but now only 2 of the houses are left, and we're actually following the heir of a 3rd house, but that house has been declared dead, so he was kind of robbed of his inheritance, and now he's kind of trying to get back to these people. And that's what this series is about, and as I said, I will update you once I'm halfway through with the first book. So it's time for a quick update because I'm halfway through The Gilded Wolves now, and I must say that so far I'm really enjoying the book, but I feel like I'm not really giving it a good chance because I read the first 100 pages while I was on the train, and then the next like 90 pages I read like here and there when I had time to read a little bit. So I just feel a little bit disconnected with the book just because of the way I've been reading it, not because of the book itself. So I definitely want to make an effort to now read the second half in a more mindful way. But I am enjoying it. We're basically having a crew of 5 characters, and we get the perspective of all of these. So we have 2 girls, Lila and Sophia. Lila is the more seductive one. I don't know how to say that. But yeah, she has basically this alter ego where she's like a famous dancer or something like that, or like an artist. And then we have Sophia, who is more the sciencey kind of character, and she really likes math, and she has sometimes a hard time understanding other people, and so she prefers like sciences because that makes more sense to her. And then we have 3 guys, and I will completely butcher names, so I'm so sorry, but we have Severin, I don't know, Severin. I can't speak French, I'm so sorry, but he's basically the leader of the group, so kind of like the Cass character in Six of Crows, and he is kind of on that revenge quest because he is the heir of one of the houses, but he has not been kind of accepted as that, so he's trying to take revenge on the woman who's responsible for that. Then we have Tristan, Tristan, I don't know. And he is kind of like, almost like a brother to Severin, because they grew up together, but they're not related. So I have some suspicions around this character that maybe he's more than we know right now, but we'll see. But basically, he really likes his, like, I don't know, like, garden and like, I think he has a pet spider and stuff like that. So he's more like a kind of like nature guy and kind of kind-hearted, and he doesn't really understand the whole revenge thing, but he wants to support his brother, basically. And then we have another character, Enrique. And Enrique is the kind of scholarly guy, so I think he's a historian and he knows just a lot of things, and I really like his perspective. He's also a little bit like quirky. I think they're all in a way a little bit like quirky. And yeah, I enjoy him. I like that with all of these characters, like, their kind of sexuality is a little bit out in the open. I can't talk today. But I think especially with Enrique, we can see that he potentially is interested in multiple sexes. I'm really enjoying this so far. I think just getting to know the characters does take a little bit of time, because there is 5 of them and we do switch the perspectives. I think the character I'm actually least interested in right now is Severin, because I also can't really understand the whole revenge thing. I think I prefer the other characters. I think they're more intriguing, more interesting, and we slowly learn also their backstories. But yeah, I'm not quite sure how fleshed out all of these characters will be by the end of this first book. And then plot-wise, we have this revenge idea. So they're right now trying to break into the kind of summer house or something, or the country estate of this one woman that Severin thinks is, like, responsible for his plight. And so I'm in the middle of all of that right now. So they just started their, like, little heist thingy, and it's already going wrong, so that's not very good. But yeah, I'm really intrigued to read on now, because I'm not quite sure where the book will go from there, like, how big of the book, or how much of the book will be about this heist now, and how much we will get after that, and if they succeed, and what happens thereafter. An interesting, like, artifact that is very powerful in this world, so if they find it, what will happen? I don't know. But yeah, so far really enjoying it. I'll give you an update once I finish the book. So I finished reading The Gilded Wolves and I'm here to give you an update. Now, I decided to give this book 4 stars. I think it is really fun and quite a good book, but there were just some things missing for me, and that's especially just the characters. They were kind of lagging to me, and then also just the world building is a little bit all over the place, I feel like. So plot-wise, this was really fun. All the, like, riddle stuff was really cool, and it was just fun seeing these characters getting into a lot of trouble. But I never really started to care about the characters, and especially with the male characters, I just had a hard time not mixing them up for a large part of the book, which already shows that I just never had enough information on them to really keep them separate in my head. And then we have one character who I never really got a grip on. Like, I was never really sure what the author was trying to tell me about him. And let's just say that something dramatic happens to that character, and I realized I did not care at all about that, and that was really sad, because when something, like, bad happens to one of the main characters, or, like, a super important side character, I want to care about that. And I think the author also wanted me to care about that, but unfortunately I did not, and that just really showed me that these characters were just not fleshed out enough for me, and they felt more like these kind of archetypes. And that's also why I think this book can be compared to Six of Crows so easily, because you basically have this, like, main power couple that is, like, very similar to Six of Crows, because you have one character who's kind of the leader of the group, but he has his insecurities, but he's also, like, super smart. And then you have this female character, and they're kind of in love, but kind of don't want to be, or kind of don't have room for that. And the female character is, like, yeah, just
super great at like physical things, so like I don't want to say sporty, that's not it, but like a dancer and super graceful and super quiet and all that stuff. So because these characters kind of stay these archetypes, even though we get like a tiny bit of information, and I think honestly the information we get on Lila, that female character, is the most interesting to me and one that I would have liked to see just explored so much more, because I think that her backstory actually has so much potential, but we get so little of it in here and so little of her feelings that yeah, I didn't really care. And then we have the issue with our like male main character. I'm just gonna call him Severin or something like that. I don't know. I will change it like every time I say the name, and it's horrible. I'm so sorry. But basically, he does something at the end of this book. Why I wanted to kick him so hard. Like, he's being such a dick at the end of this book to Lila, and I hate him for it. I'm sorry. Like, I wasn't really interested in him in the first place because he's basically on this revenge plot. And yeah, like, you feel like you're entitled to something and you didn't get it and stuff, but I don't know. Like, men have such problems. But then he is such a dick to Lila. The only person who's like super supportive of him and tries to help. And yeah, I don't like him. And that's really sad because like he's the like main character guy. I don't know. So yeah, I definitely had my issues with this, but I still think it's a fun read, it's a quick read. So if you're looking for that, you will probably enjoy it, and that's why I gave it 4 stars. I'm gonna go into a couple of spoilers now, so I will use the chapter so you can jump over it. Just make sure if you have not read the book that you do that because you don't want to be spoiled for what I'm gonna say next. So, yeah, what I thought was quite interesting with this book is that at the end, and we have this like this final battle scene, they're in the catacombs, which I thought was really cool. Like, for some reason I did not see it coming. Even though it's quite obvious, like, what's the cool part about Paris, you know, apart from the Eiffel Tower? So that I thought was really cool, like having this like headquarters thing of the fallen house in the catacombs, and so they're going down there and stuff. For them being so smart all the time, like just running in there into this trap felt a little bit off to me. Like, they had a bit of a plan, but like everything that happened in the catacombs was just not a plan. And also, what I realized is that this whole thing with like shit starting to move and then they have to like solve a riddle and then it won't move anymore, it confused the heck out of me. Like, I did not understand what was going on, especially when they were in this like country residence thing in the secret library part. Like, I did not understand what was going on. Like, some characters entered and then there was this spiral thing and like a ball of fire or something, and then they just had to put in a number and then it all stopped. And I don't know why. I don't understand why. Like, what is the idea of that? Like, does this happen every time when the matriarch enters this thing? I don't know. And then the other characters, I guess they entered through another way, and that's why it didn't happen to them. But it was not clear to me at all. I did not understand. And then the same thing happens when they're in the catacombs, because like the fragment is waking up, whatever that means. And so again, the ground starts moving, but then it does have this like thing that can stop it, but they have to put it in the right place, and to do that, they have to solve a riddle again. Why? Why? I do not understand this. So, yeah, the world building was definitely very wonky towards the end for me. Like, I did like the whole idea of like the forged objects and then they're like special and have magic and stuff, but like all the like puzzle moving things pieces, I did not understand why. Like, yes, it's cool to have them solve these puzzles, but why are they there in the first place? What's the reason? Okay, so that's one thing I was a little bit iffy about, but then we have that whole like battle scene and they get out of there and it's all fine and the people get arrested and stuff like that. And then suddenly we have a ball where they just want to celebrate. And the, like, evil guy, we still don't know who he even is. Like, we know nothing about this evil guy, which he's, yeah, he's kind of, like, mustache twirling, like, I'm evil. But, yeah, he has some kind of reason to do things, I guess. And so he comes to the ball, and he basically kills Tristan. And again, first of all, I don't know why. Like, what is the point? Like, he had, I thought, some kind of goal to, I don't know, have eternal life or something. I don't know. What was his goal? I don't understand. But why would going to this ball after escaping and killing one of them serve any of his goals? I don't know. I don't understand. But that was, like, so unexpected and didn't make any sense to me that, as I said, I just did not care about Tristan's death at all. And then it moves on, we still get a little bit more story, and we learn that he was the one who killed birds to keep them in his, like, garden shed or whatever, and Lila finds that and is disturbed by it, and then it's talking about a cracked mind, and I'm like, What is this? Why? How? What is this about? I don't understand. Like, is this supposed to be like, yeah, he wasn't, like, a good guy because he killed birds? Or, I don't know. I don't know what the author was trying to tell me with that. It was just confusion to me. And so, yeah, these were the parts that I just was a little bit overwhelmed by and didn't really know what to do with it. But apart from that, like, the setup of the story and how they, like, go to this house and, you know, solving stuff and having plans, it was really fun. But I still feel like I have not understood everything that happened. And that's kind of unfortunate. And then I thought, you know what, I'll just start reading Silver Serpents. And I'm not gonna go into this just yet, because I will talk about that when I'm more into it. But just reading the epilogue kind of destroys the whole premise of the first book, because we have the matriarch of House Core, and we have an assumption about her, and that is that she is the reason why Severin doesn't have his inheritance. Right at the end of Gilded Wolves, we learn that that's not true, that he actually is not the heir. And then at the beginning of the second book, we learn that she loved him, she adored him when he was a child because she couldn't have any children of her own. And then I'm thinking back to a scene in Gilded Wolves where she did not recognize him. Like, sorry, but if I was obsessed with a person when they were a child, I think I would recognize them again. Like, I mean, he was, like, what, 18 or something when they lost touch? I don't know. I don't understand that. I feel like there is just quite some loose ends here. And that's frustrating me a little bit, because I like my stories neat. I'm just gonna continue with the second book now. And I'll keep you updated when I have reached the halfway point of that one. So, I am now halfway through the Silvered Serpents. And unfortunately, so far, this is not going so well. So, I really did not enjoy the ending of The Gilded Wolves. And I feel like this set the second book in a direction that I'm not really enjoying. So, I definitely have to force myself to read this. And all that this is kind of doing is reminding me of how badly I want to read the Grisha books. And that's really quite sad and not at all what I wanted from this series. Now, in this book, we have a change of scenery. From Paris, we are going to Russia. So it is definitely a very cold setting, a lot of snow and ice that is described. And I think because we're going into spring, this also kind of feels out of place for me. I'm a seasonal reader, and so it's just a bit late in winter for me to pick up this book.
Apart from that, I do enjoy a Russian setting, and I think that it is interesting, and we also see our characters kind of react quite differently to that. For example, Sophia, who is from Poland, does sometimes feel a little bit more at home, but then also sees why her family left that home, and the kind of dangers that linger there more than the other characters. I think that, yeah, this book is definitely trying to be different from the first book, but then also follow on from the first book, and it's just, it's not quite working for me. So I want to go into a couple of spoilers to explain that a little bit more. So if you have not read this book, I would recommend skipping over the next part using the chapters. Now at the end of The Gilded Wolves, we see Tristan's death and this book now deals with the grief that these characters experience because of that. And we also see at the end of The Gilded Wolves that Lila knows a secret, that maybe Tristan wasn't the person that they all thought he was, that there was something darker going on with him. And now in the second book, we learn that Severin actually finds out about that, and he's like really pissed off. And I just hate the direction his character goes in. Like, I found him a little bit irritating in the first book because he only ever cared about his revenge. And then at the end of the first book, we learned that there isn't anything to take revenge on, basically. And now in this one, he has kind of this thought that he needs to become less human so he can protect his friends. And basically, this is a character that can only deal with hurt by hurting others, and that's just something I do not enjoy reading about. Like, he is so mean, and he treats all his friends so badly in this book, and I think that this especially hinders my enjoyment of the book because he is very definitely a main character, and even though we get the perspective of the other characters, they always resolve around him, except maybe for Sophia's chapters, just because of the way that Sophia perceives the world. She's not that much affected, even though she is definitely affected as well, but it's not like her thoughts constantly like revolve around that. But especially with Lila, I think the way that she's treated in this book is just horrible, and I hate reading about it. And then later on in this book, we get this new character called Eva. That's not a name. What was that? Okay, so the German version would be Eva, and the English version probably Eva. But I'm gonna stick with Eva for now. So we get that new character, and she seems to be very interested in Severin, and she tries to produce drama between herself and Lila and kind of distinguish herself in that way. And I like that Lila is not really playing along with that, but still I just don't like these interactions at all. And I hate this new character because she's just mean on no grounds. Like, What even is she doing? Like, I don't understand. I really hate that addition. And then we have also the patriarch of the Russian house, and there's only one house in Russia from this order. And he is so sus. Like, let me just say that. Like, first of all, he has a hurt hand. We have no idea what happened to his hand, but I don't trust him. And the second thing is that he's obsessed with hair for some reason, and he's just sus. He's so, I don't know, I don't trust him at all, and whatever is going on, that can't be right. That just can't be right. So, yeah, I really don't like these new characters. I just really don't know what their purpose is. And then we have more information on Delphine, who was like a second mother or an aunt to Severin, but then she turned away from him when she found out that he's not the heir of his house, and now he can't forgive her at all. Which on one hand I understand, but then again the way he just acts is just so infuriating to me, and I just don't enjoy reading about that at all. Now, what I can say about this book is that the actual case is interesting, and I do enjoy that part, I think, a little bit more than in the first book, because for now I can follow it a little bit better. In the first book, I just got so confused with some of the things that were going on. So I feel like for now, the like puzzle and secret elements in this one, I do prefer a little bit more, and I feel like it is described more in a way that I can understand. But that might still change in the second half, because that was also something that happened in the second half of The Gilded Wolves for me. But yeah, so far, unfortunately, this is not going so well, and I definitely have to force myself a little bit to read this. It is still quite a quick read, and I hope to finish this soon. But depending on where it goes and how the characters develop, I'm pretty sure I will take a break after this one and then read the last one a little bit later, just because I'm scared to get into a reading slump if I push this too much right now. And I already feel like I always want to listen to my audiobook instead of reading, because I'm enjoying the audiobook more than I currently have, and that's never a good sign. So yeah, that's it for now. I'll update you when I finish the book. So, last night I finished reading The Silvered Serpents, and unfortunately, this book just did not live up to the hype for me. I decided to give it 3.5 stars. I think that there are still quite fun elements in here, but I realized that I just really don't care about the characters. And especially during the end scene of this, I could feel that, like, I was just not moved by it at all, even though we have some, like, pretty tragic scenes. So, yeah. I don't know. This is just not working out for me, unfortunately. But I'm still gonna read the last book. I'm just gonna take a bit of a break for now to kind of, I don't know, just get my head into another mood, I guess. So, yeah, this book leaves off with a bit of, you can't really say a cliffhanger, but I would say that the whole, storyline of this is not resolved by the end of this, so you definitely have to read the last book to know what happens now. I felt like the ending was a bit underwhelming in that sense. We do have a couple of reveals, but I found them very easy to see. Like, I had some suspicions and they were absolutely correct, so the foreshadowing or like the hints were just way too obvious for me. And yeah, there were also a couple of things where I thought, in theory, they should have made me feel something, but they did not. And that was like really sad to me. So yeah, overall, I'm a bit underwhelmed with this series so far, and that's very, very sad. And I wish it would be different. But if you have read the book, I'm going to go into a couple of spoilers now. If you haven't, I would highly recommend using the chapters, jumping over this part, so you don't get spoiled. But yeah, the ending is quite a lot. We have a lot of like violence that is also something that maybe I should say in the spoiler-free part, but something that I struggle with a little bit, that this book feels very YA, but it gets violent in some scenes. Like, I don't understand that. So yeah, that's also a little bit of a discrepancy that I see here. But yeah, talking about spoilers, in the end, we obviously learn that Ruslan, or whatever you want to call him, he is the doctor, he's the guy from the Fallen House, and he infiltrated the Russian House of the Order to get in contact with our characters. And so he starts attacking them. He knocks out Enrique, and then he attacks Sophia in the grotto, and he also sends Eva to get Lila. And a lot of this just did not make sense again for me, because why would they leave Severin alone? Like, he's just in bed, and the whole like deal with Eva being like, yeah, I just did that so you would have like a nice last night together. Like, what the hell? That did not make any sense. We have a bit of a sex scene, but it's definitely fade to black, so there's not a lot going on with that one. But it is pretty obvious what's happening. And
Yeah, and then they just leave him in the room when Lila gets out and gets captured by Eva, and I don't understand why. And then he goes down and he sees that Enrique is still in the library, and again, I don't understand why. Why is Sophia the only one that is in the prison cell? It didn't make any sense to me. Like, why knock Enrique out and then just lock him in the library? Like, what? But yeah, so he gets him, and then they want to confront them, and then they get captured again. And then for some reason, the matriarch has a Severin and gets him to be in the Leviathan, and I do not understand how. Like, how are the logistics of that? Because the other, like, the evil guys are in the grotto, and so they captured them outside of the grotto, and the matriarch is disguised as a guard, and so she's supposed to take Severin to the holding cell, which is away from the grotto, and instead somehow she ends up with him through the grotto in the Leviathan. Like, what? I don't understand. And for some reason Hypnos is there as well, or however you say his name, and yeah, he's just sleeping because of something, kind of like the blood forging, whatever. And why did she not get the other ones? Like, is the thing so small? Because I also did not understand that part. Like, in the end she kind of sacrifices herself, but because I did not understand what was going on, I couldn't feel anything about it, and that made me quite mad, because I thought her story arc was like super interesting, and we see basically nothing of it. We only see all the moments when Severin is like nasty to her because he thinks that she's the evil person. So yeah, again, there were just so many like logistic things I did not understand about this ending that I really didn't care about the characters. And I feel like because this is in a way too plot focused for me, but the plot doesn't really make sense, I also don't get through to the characters. So for example, in one of the scenes, Ruslan cuts off Enrique's ear, which is like super dramatic. But it did not make me feel anything. And then we get his perspective and he's just like, yeah, it throbs a little bit. I'm like, okay, like, he can even see the irony in it. And I don't understand, I'm sorry. So yeah, this was almost a little bit ridiculous to read for me, just because I was not connecting the dots, I was confusion. So yeah, I don't know. And so one thing that I thought was like very obvious is that Ruslan is the evil guy and Eva is helping him. That was like so easy to spot because he always had his arm in a sling. I think I even mentioned it in the previous update. So that was like super suspicious, because we know that the evil guy from the first book also did stuff to his arm with like kind of like a self-harm thing. So yeah, it was just so obvious that he's the culprit, and again, the way that Eva was portrayed, it was very obvious that she would be on the evil side for this, because she really refused to have any friendly feelings towards any of these people, even though Lila repeatedly offered her at least some respect, or, you know, just a little bit of calm. So yeah, I don't know, that was very easy to spot. And then we have the moment where they realize it's not the lyrics they're looking for, but the lyra. And again, that was so obvious. It was painful. So yeah, I'm really a bit disappointed, and I think 3.5 stars is still a kind rating, basically. So on Goodreads I gave it 3 stars, because you can't do half stars there, and I could not give this 4 stars. So yeah, it's very sad, and as I said, I'm gonna take a break now. We do have, as I said, kind of this cliffhanger, because now Severin went off with the evil people to the temple where he wants to play the lyre, and yeah, and all of our other characters just have to figure shit out now, I guess. So we also have this trope where they get kind of separated, and I I'm just not a big fan of that. Like, if you give us a nice group of characters, don't separate them. That's not what we want. So I'm a bit worried going into the last book that this will be a bit disappointing as well, but I'm still gonna read it because I want to know how it all ends and what happens at the end. And then, yeah, I'll let you know what I think. So I am halfway through The Bronze Beast, finally, after a little bit of a break, which I think was a good thing. I think taking a break, reading some other books definitely helped me go into this one. We do pick up right away, so there is no gap between the second and the third book, and we just follow what has been going on in the second book. So I would definitely say that the second book doesn't really stand on its own very well. You definitely need the conclusion to get somewhere with the storyline. This one I'm still a bit frustrated with, but for different reasons than the second book. I think the characters are not as insufferable anymore. I still feel like this is a very weird book where I just don't know whether this is YA and these people are supposed to act like teenagers or whether they should be more adult, because similar with Six of Crows, you have them being like these, yeah, like important people in their areas, but they read like they're 16. And really, the way they deal with their conflicts is so immature. So I think I'm still a little bit frustrated with that in the third book, but the second book was definitely worse because, yeah, just some things have turned around a little bit now, but I just really don't like the way these characters are written. And then what really frustrates me with this one is that it is set in Venice, and I have been to Venice a couple of times now, and I wouldn't say that I'm an expert or anything, but it's always different if you read a book set in a place that you know. And so with this one, what just really frustrates me are the inconsistencies, because there were just things I did not understand. There is this one scene with Enrique in the first half of this book, and I'm not spoiling anything in particular here, but basically he has a meeting and he's unsure what to wear, so he then gets dressed and goes from the Rialto Bridge to Piazza di San Marco in 10 minutes. Like, he gets dressed and goes all that way in 10 minutes. And I'm like, well, he's kind of quick. Like, he definitely did not get lost on his way, because, yeah, like, Venice is not an easy city to get around. But maybe he took a boat. I don't know. That could be quicker. I don't know. But that was something where I was like, I don't know. It just seems a little bit like a stretch that you could make that in 10 minutes. But okay, like, I need 10 minutes to get dressed. And this is like historical times when, you know, dressing was even more of an effort. But okay. But then the next sentence is that he has been staring at the pigeons for 20 minutes. And I'm like, what? Like 10 minutes ago he was still at his place. Like, how has he been staring at pigeons now? I don't understand. So yeah, it's just these little things. Like, also there is this, in the same scene, this like very detailed description of the Piazza di San Marco, and it's not correct. Like, I don't know if my perspective is wrong, like where he was standing and looking at these things, but in my head, the way he described where everything was didn't make sense. Like, when I'm standing there, the buildings are in different places than he described. But whatever. So yeah, it's just these things are just a little bit annoying to me, to be honest. And then we have the Italian. Now, I actually don't quite remember whether we get any Russian in the second book, because my Russian is non-existent. Like, even though I had taken a course for half a year, I remember the bare minimums. Like, the first thing I always want to be able to say in a language is that I don't understand, and I can do that in Russian, but that's where it ends. So I don't remember whether there was like actual Russian sentences in the second book, but we do have actual Italian sentences in this one, and they're not all grammatically correct, and it bothers me. because my Italian also isn't great. So whenever I come across one of these sentences, I'm like, am I wrong or is the book wrong? But then the mistakes are not consistent. So in the next sentence, the same thing might be correct suddenly. So for example, it's like a very minor thing. And I know this might sound really stupid, but in Italian, you have an E as a word, like only E is the word. And then you have an E with an apostrophe. And those are completely different words. Like the one where it's just an E, it means end. And the one with the apostrophe means is. And in one sentence, it is used incorrectly. The author wanted to say is, but said end. And then in the next sentence, it is done correctly. And I'm like, what? So yeah, just like, why people, why? I think if you really want to put a different language in your books, then do it correctly. Because in this way, it just feels like you don't know what you're doing. And it is a little bit sad. So yeah, these are the more frustrating bits. Plot-wise, it is kind of interesting, but it's nothing different from the first two books. They're kind of running around. There is like things I understand and things where I'm like, what? Like, but I feel like some of these things do get explained a little bit better. So for example, we have another one of those scenes where two groups of people want to enter the same place, but they have to solve different riddles. And I'm like, how? It's the same place they want to enter. But then it is described that there's actually multiple places to enter it, which then makes sense. Is this great? No, unfortunately not. And to be honest, I would much rather be reading Crooked Kingdom right now, but I'm not. I'm reading this. So let me go into a couple of spoilers now for the people who have read this book, just to, you know, remind you of some of the things that are going on and how I feel about them. So please skip over this part if you have not read the book. But basically, the group is separated. So Severin is now with the like evil people, with Roslyn and Eva, and they're doing their evil things, and Severin is trying to be so cool and just play cool and play the game and whatever. And he is a little bit less frustrating now because he has seen that he has really hurt his friends, and he started reflecting a little bit on that. On the other hand, he still thinks he can fix all of that with a fucking liar. And I'm like, oh, come on, dude, like, no, that's not how friends work. And yeah, so that's the one part, like, okay, he's doing a little bit of character development, luckily. And then on the other part, we have all of our other characters together. So we have Sophia, Enrique, Laila, and Hypno, whatever his name is. We have them together, and they're trying to kind of find their groove with a missing piece. So I think that's actually quite an interesting storyline that we could have seen in the second book when they lost Tristan, but they just fell apart. So it's nice to see them now try to remain this like group of people, do their thing, even though Severin is kind of missing from that group. And we have a lot of like very different feelings. The one that I'm actually interested in is still Sophia, because I think her storyline with her sister is very touching. And when the scene happens where she loses the letter, that was like such a shock to me, and I was like, oh my god, no. So yeah, I need to know what's in that letter. And I don't understand how you can have one of those letters and not open them. Like, that is driving me crazy, let's be real. But yeah, that's like a storyline that I very much am interested in. I want to see how it, you know, evolves. And with Laila, obviously, I really enjoyed her backstory in the first place. But now it just gets a little bit repetitive. Like, yeah, she's gonna die in like 4 days, and now she's gonna die in like 3 days. And I feel like because the way this story is told, I don't feel her pain. And I think that because as a reader, you are always like, yeah, they're gonna fix it in the end. Like, duh. It is not really like tangible fear, I guess. And similar with Enrique, I just get so frustrated with his damn ear. Like, why cut off his ear when it's nothing to him? Like, all he ever does is say, oh, it throbs a little bit. I'm like, Guy, your ear was cut off. I don't know, like, I've never had my ear cut off, but I would imagine it sucks. Like, shouldn't it impale your hearing and stuff? I don't know. This just, it's odd to me, to be honest. All the, like, there's even one moment where Stefan was like, oh my god, is he gonna hurt when his ear was cut off? And I'm like, no, he's not. Don't worry about it. Like, it throbs a little bit sometimes. Then one character I really enjoy, but because of his, like, relationship to the other characters, I feel like it's not giving me much, is Hypno, whatever his name is. Because he's kind of like the outsider and he's trying to find his place with the group, and it just gets so awkward all the time, and that's something that actually makes me really sad, because, yeah, I think he's a good character, and I think he could be a great character, but the others don't really let him in, so we never really get him as a, like, member, and we never read from his perspective and stuff like that, so that's kind of sad. And so, yeah, I don't know. And so now, just when the second part is over, we do get the scene where Severin is kind of killed, probably, maybe, or hurt, whatever. But again, I didn't feel anything. I was just like, yeah, okay, shock value, whatever. That's not what I want to feel when I read a book. Oh my god. So, we'll see where it goes now. I hope they leave Venice soon, because I can't take more of this. And I hope that I will be very quick with the second half now. And I will update you very soon about that one.
So I finished reading The Bronzed Beast today, and this is finally done. I have finished the series. I'm very proud of myself. I decided to give this last book 3.5 stars as well. To be honest, going into it, I was expecting worse, and so I'm quite relieved that it wasn't. I actually think I like the plot and the characters in this one more than in the second book. I really was bored with the second book and just overall not a fan, while with this one I definitely had more things that I enjoyed about it, and I think that the way the characters behaved was just, yeah, just a little bit better again. Still, yeah, I've talked about things that irked me with the descriptions of Venice, which unfortunately is a place that I know. So some of the things just bugged me a little bit, but that was mainly in the first half, because in the second half, they're not really in the city that much anymore. Again, I feel like in this one we have a little bit less of the puzzle solving bits. I think the other two books had more of that. But what I really am missing in this series, and I think the first book does it the most, is that we have fun with these characters. Because when I think about, like, series like Six of Crows, yes, there are stakes, but the characters still have fun in certain moments, and there is a certain, like, lightness to these heist stories that I usually enjoy, and I feel like in this series that was missing for me. And these characters just took themselves way too seriously, especially the main character of Severin, whatever his name is. So that's, I think, why I didn't really connect to the characters, because while I think there were interesting aspects added to them, for me personally, they just took themselves way too seriously, and we even have almost like a villain origin story in the second book, and then it just turns around in the third book again, but I don't know. It was just never really something I could follow intellectually, kind of what was going on with this character. So I think that's why overall this story doesn't really work for me. I just wanted it to be a bit more lighthearted, a bit more fun, and I didn't get that, unfortunately. Now, in this last book, at the end, we also get the whole idea of, what is it called, repatriating objects from museums. And while I think this is a very, very important topic, it just felt a little bit wasted on these last couple of pages that we get. And it also felt way too simple. Like, I think the concept in of itself is very complicated, and there is a lot of things to consider, especially with the question of who is actually the owner of certain objects, and, you know, where did they come from, how were they acquired. It's not that simple, and this book made it sound very simple, like we just send them back to where that stuff came from. And that's just not how it works. And I think this book, I don't know, I feel like this is like the beginning of the discussion, and the discussion has moved on quite a bit from that. Like, we can agree that this is an important thing to be done, but just having like these like two characters where only one has even historical knowledge, I don't know. It just felt way too easy for me personally. So yeah, overall, I think this is a fun story, but I would not recommend it. I think there are so many more interesting books out there. Unfortunately, not my favorite, but do with that whatever you will. I will go into a couple of spoilers now for the end. So if you have not read the book, then thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it. Leave a like or a nice comment. Let me know whether you consider picking these books up now. And have a great day. And for all of you who have read the book and want to hear a little bit more, not going to go into great depth here. But yeah, I did like the second half more again than the first half. And I think the third quarter of the book was actually what I enjoyed. So from the moment where we think we have killed Roslyn until he obviously pops up again, which was not a surprise at all. Like, I would have been surprised if it wouldn't have happened. That was the part I enjoyed, because that was when our characters finally got into this like more adventurous and like odd kind of vibe that I enjoyed from the first book. And I think just the villain of this book, he does not work for me personally. I don't understand the whole idea of him. I think that we don't get enough information. We just get kind of like this description that he wanted power, but then he did something and then he went mad. But he doesn't really look that mad, to be honest, and he still wants power, but we never know why. Like, the whole thing with the fucking hair, like, what the hell? Like, is he really in it for the hair? I don't know. And yeah, I just didn't like that, and I don't like him as a villain, and I have this issue when villains seem to be too strong or too undefeatable, because I don't know, I just don't have fun with that concept. So if someone is killed over and over and just pops up again and it's like, hey, haha, you can't kill me because of something, I just don't like that. So yeah, it wasn't my favorite. So yeah. And then the whole ending feels like this like big epilogue that we get, where we hear about like years and years and years later what's happening to these characters. And it just felt quite dragged out to me personally. I had things where I just did not understand what was going on. Like, why did he adopt the two kids from Italy? Nobody knows. Nobody knows. Yeah, I don't know. And then this whole thing with like 100 years later, Lila suddenly appears again. Why? Like, this whole explanation of she's gonna be in the temple until all the forged things are gone, or something like that. Like, why would that take 100 years? I don't understand. And yeah, so it was kind of a sweet moment, I guess. But at the same time, I think, like, I don't know. I like this description of him being a ghost and just waiting for her to come back. But I really didn't understand why that took so long. Yeah, I think the rest was kind of like sweet, like the way that Enrique finally figured out that he wants to teach people. Wow. I thought it was so weird. We get like one super short chapter from Hypnos, whatever, however you want to say it. I did not understand why we got that. Like, what was that even? But yeah, it was nice to like see them in the end together, like Enrique, Hypno, and Sophia. I also don't know how I feel about the whole letter situation, like what was actually in the letter. Like, I really like the description where it said that Lila is just hoping for an unexpected joy when things are unknown. I really like that, but I don't know. Like, what is in the letter was actually so out of the blue and weird that... And then it wasn't even picked up again. Like, we didn't even see anything about that. So, I don't know. Yeah. Unfortunately, this really was my favorite. This whole, like, Lila in the bed thing felt also very weird to me. Like, am I the only one? Am I the only one who thinks that was really weird? I don't know. But I'm glad it's over now. And I will unhaul these books, even though they are quite pretty, but they're also falling apart very easily. And I don't think I will ever want to reread those. So, unfortunately, the first series of this year was not a success. But since the next one I'm going to tackle is the Dandelion Dynasty series, I'm pretty sure the next vlog will be a success. Or I will be mad. Like, if I don't like those books, I will be mad. So, have a great day and I'll talk to you soon. Bye!